Ephesians 4:12 calls us to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, to build up the body of Christ. Every day across the state of Kentucky, lives are impacted through various Baptist ministries. These efforts reach the homeless, impoverished, at-risk youth, refugees, crisis pregnancies, and countless others. Every day, they help meet physical needs while showing God's love and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. But to continue, these ministries need your support. By giving to the Eliza Broaddus offering, you will equip these ministries to reach those in need of the gospel, in need of life change, in need of the love of Jesus Christ.
Well, good morning. We want to welcome you to Campbellsville Baptist Church. My name is Jeremy Litton. I'm the Director of Children's Ministries here. If you're a guest with us this morning, we're so glad that you are with us. If you look in your bulletin, there's a little connection card. We would love to get to know you a little more, have a little more information about you. So if you'd like to fill that out and then put it in the offering plate a little later on in the service, we'd love to connect with you. The video there was the Eliza Broaddus video. We're taking up an offering for that mission. If you don't know, and if you couldn't tell from the video, the Eliza Broaddus offering focuses on missions in Kentucky. And so if you look again in your bulletin, there's a season of prayer, a little paper right there. And so that's going to tell you all about the Eliza Broaddus project and the offering that we're going to be taking up for that. And there's also a little paper here for you to put your offering in. So pray about that. Give to that offering. It's a great for local ministries. And so we encourage you to give for that. So we're going to pray and then we're going to start with worship. All right, let's pray. Lord, Dad, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time we have to gather as a family and to praise your name. Thank you so much for your son, for sending him to die on the cross for our sins. And I pray that as we worship and we learn more about your word, Father, that your presence today will be felt. And that if someone here doesn't know you, that they will feel you and experience your presence today for the first time and come to know you. We love you, and in your name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Let's get on up out of those seats and let's praise the Lord this morning. Zephaniah 3:17, the scripture says, "The Lord your God is in your midst. He is a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing. This morning we are here and we can celebrate a Savior and a Lord that is mighty to save. He exults over us with singing. Join us in this celebration this morning. For your power, Father, that you loved us so much that you sent Jesus to die on the cross. Lord, that his agony and his pain, Father, was enough to save us from our sins. Lord, we just are so grateful for that this morning. We are so grateful that the power of the cross can bring us to you. In Jesus' name we pray as we continue our worship. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
to see the dawn.
Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest days, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten men, nailed to a cross of wood. Pierced the power of the cross, Christ became sin for us. He took the blame, he bore
this morning. Go ahead and be seated as we continue in this time of worship. We have a new song that we'd like to sing for you this morning and want you to join in. It will be real catchy onto it, but it's a wonderful song, just celebrating and recognizing the name of Jesus for all that it is.
Mm-hmm.
beautiful and wonderful. Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? And all the world can come to him and have their sins removed. Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? Is the name beautiful? Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? All the world can come.
Son of God is one of us, the lover of our souls. Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful?
Here's the chorus, Eternal King. Of Jesus powerful.
Is the name of Jesus powerful?
Oh, yes it is.
Isn't the name of Jesus powerful?
Oh, powerful.
Chains are broken when it's spoken, every knee must bow.
Pray with me as ushers come forward. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day, and thank you for bringing us all to your house safely today. Thank you for your love and mercy on us, Father. I pray that you will bless all who give today and show them the love in a mighty way. Bless his tithes and offerings to further your kingdom, Father. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Kids 1 through 5, you can come down to meet Mr. Jeremy for Kids XP.
What a
It's one of my favorite.
One of my favorite songs, so thank you so much. Take your copy of God's Word and go to the New Testament. Go to the Gospel of Luke. Last Sunday, we started Luke chapter 15, and we looked at, studied together the story of the prodigal son and the loving father. And after a little bit of really just praying and asking the Lord, what direction would you have me to go? We were going to continue anyway in this Grace is Greater series, but I really felt like we needed to come back and we needed to also look at the story of the older son and the loving father. And so that's what we're going to do this morning. We also began a discussion last Sunday morning speaking about if you had ever lost anything. And I kind of shared with you guys how I'm really good at losing various things. And I ran across an article this week, and you, some of you guys were really, really quick. I put this up on social media, and you guys were really quick to jump in. But how many of you either have a, this is an Amazon Echo Dot, I believe, right? Where's Lindsay? I lost her. Oh, she's helping with children. All right. Well, anyway, Lindsay Wayne was so good to let me borrow her Amazon Echo Dot. How many of you have a device like this, either the Google Home or whatever? All right, a lot of you do. So one thing that I found this week, this was according to an article by CNET.com. You really need this device, according to them, all right? That's what they say. It's as simple as this. You tell Alexa, all right, to remember if you're really bad about losing things, all right? You tell Alexa to remember where you placed something that you'll need to find again. For example, you say, Alexa, and by the way, I was kind of a little scared to plug it in this morning because I didn't know what Alexa was going to do, all right? So, Alexa, remember I put my, for example, if you're really bad about maybe losing your birth certificate. Alexa, I placed my birth certificate in the second drawer of my filing cabinet. And then, lo and behold, when you're looking for that item that at some point you're probably going to lose again, you just say, Alexa, where did I put my birth certificate? And Alexa will then repeat exactly where you said that your item will be. Now, sounds pretty simple, right? Maybe. At least two, maybe even three huge issues with this. First, Alexa cannot remember what you don't tell her to remember or tell it to remember. So that would be a problem for me. I don't know about you, because I would fail to tell Alexa to remember whatever document or whatever I was trying to. So that would obviously cause some issues and problems. Secondly, this is the second thing I kind of thought of. If any of you have any devices like this, I have been told you need to be careful what you say around devices like this, right? Because they will repeat, and you know, you just need to be careful with what you're telling your devices like this or what you're saying, because they're listening, all right? They're always, little brother or little sister is always listening. So, and I figured, thirdly, I have something a whole lot better than Alexa. I have my wife, Mandy, and anytime I need to find something, I just ask Mandy, and Mandy knows exactly where it is. And before I had my wife, Mandy, before I was blessed to be married for Mandy for almost 20 years, I had my mother that helped me to find everything that I was looking for. So guys, don't worry about it. Either ask your mom or ask your wife, all right? One of the two, and you'll be fine. If you think about it, we really excel at creating devices that help us to find person, places, or things that are physically lost. But the fact of the matter is, mankind has never and will never be able to invent something to find or save someone who is spiritually lost. That's the work of God through Jesus Christ. So, the word lost is a key word in Luke chapter 15. Jesus taught, if you will, a trilogy of parables, all with one key ingredient. Each person or thing was lost. There was a lost sheep, a lost coin, and a lost son. And the beauty of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son is that they were all found. The context of Luke chapter 15 is key to interpreting these parables correctly. In fact, you really need to go to the beginning of Luke chapter 15 and just the first couple of verses. So listen, and then Jesus gets into the trilogy of parables. Beginning in verse 1, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" And so where we are in this third parable, the parable of the lost son, I really like to look at it as the parable, or refer to it as the parable of the gracious, loving Heavenly Father. Remember, he is the hero of the story. In fact, the loving Father is not only the hero of this story, the gracious, loving Heavenly Father is the hero of the entire Bible. And so when you come this morning, it's helpful for us to understand and interpret Luke chapter 15 correctly. And we can only do that if we look at the very beginning when Jesus is ministering and serving and teaching and hanging out with what they referred to, what the religious leaders referred to as the sinners. And so the sinners would be represented in our story this morning, or what we studied last Sunday, by the prodigal son, by the reckless living of the prodigal son. And that means, therefore, that the Pharisees, the older son would be representative of the Pharisees, of the religious leaders. And so that's what we're going to study together this morning. And what we will see is this. This is really, if you will, the sermon in a nutshell. Our Heavenly Father seeks those who are far from God, whether a prodigal son or daughter, whether it be a self-righteous son or daughter. Our Heavenly Father seeks those that are far from God, and He celebrates when they are found. Pray with me. Father, we thank You for what we've already experienced this morning in time of corporate worship and being able to give back to You through tithes and offerings. As we've been able to pray, God, it's as we've been able to spend time in small group Bible study this morning, truly, Lord, it has been a blessing to be in Your presence. Lord, even now as our hearts are prepared to walk through Your Word together, our minds also think about those who are in the path of this hurricane that's been strengthened to a Category 5. Lord, we're concerned for our loved ones. We're concerned for people there on the Florida, the east coast of Florida and the east coast of the United States. And we just pray, Lord, that that storm would begin to weaken and dissipate. Lord, that You would protect the people there on the east coast. And Lord, we pray through this, what could be an unbelievable tragedy, Lord, we pray that God's people and the gospel of Jesus Christ will shine forth in the midst of this darkness. We pray for churches like our church and other churches that will send teams to help and to minister and to serve to people that will be impacted by this storm. And we pray, Lord, that as physical needs will be met, we also pray, God, that spiritual needs will be met as well. So, Lord, protect these precious people. Lord, they're created in Your image and Your likeness. And, Lord, I pray that the church will stand tall and ready to serve and minister in the name of Jesus. And this is our prayer. In Your name we pray. Amen. As we continue through God's Word together this morning, I want you to look at with me some really timeless truths from this passage of Scripture together. First, I want you to notice the sinful characteristics of a heart that needs changing. There are some sinful characteristics here of a heart that need changing. We see it here in the older son. Look with me beginning at verse number 25 in Luke chapter 15. "Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, 'Your brother is come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, because he has received him back safe and sound.' But he was angry and refused to go in. And his father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, 'Look, these many years I have served you, and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him.'" So as we look this morning at these sinful characteristics of a heart that needs changing, I reference these almost in the form of a question. So it's a question, these are questions that we need to ask ourselves, if you will, this morning. First, do you have an angry spirit of grumbling? Do you have an angry spirit of grumbling? This is something that we notice in this older son. It doesn't take long to see his angry spirit, to see his grumbling spirit. The servant will give the son, the older son, all the information that he needs in verses 25 through 27. It's interesting to note that the loving father watched daily, remember, for the prodigal to return home, but the older son, in contrast, seemed totally unconcerned. He didn't even know that his younger brother had returned home until the servants were the ones to actually tell him. And then we see the response of the older son in these verses. He was angry, the Word of God tells us, and he refused to go in. In other words, instead of rejoicing with the father and with the servants, with the others, he responds with resentment instead. This attitude really is a reflection of the Pharisees and the scribes complain about Jesus' fellowship with the sinners that we read about in Luke chapter 15, verse 2, there at the very beginning. This is expressing anger instead of rejoicing at spiritual good. There's a problem with that. This, if you will, that's the heart of a Pharisee. A Pharisee will express anger or resentment at something instead of at a spiritual good. It's something good that has happened. They will express anger and resentment instead of rejoicing at spiritual good. Furthermore, don't miss the son's refusal to celebrate was also dishonoring to the father. In fact, he dishonors the father as much as the younger prodigal son dishonored the father. And a lot of times we don't look at it, we think, oh, well, he lived a reckless life, the younger son did, and so, boy, he was totally dishonoring to the father, and yes, he was, but likewise, the older son was just as dishonoring to the father with his attitude and his actions. As I studied this week, I began to think about the local church, our church, churches in general. And I wish I could say that this type of attitude does not exist in today's church, that this was merely a first century problem and not a 21st century issue, but that would be totally untrue. There are still people in the church today that express resentment and anger at spiritual good instead of rejoicing. And church, the fact of the matter is, if this resembles you, you need to check your heart. You need to have a conversation with the Lord that includes repentance. By the way, a side note here, did you notice that father's response to his angry son? Don't miss this. In fact, I want to read it again. Look at verse number 28 in the text. The Bible tells us that the son was angry in verse 28, and he refused to go in. And then notice, his father came out and entreated him. The tense there, the language of the New Testament, is the imperfect tense. It tells us that he continually entreated. He continually implored. He nearly begged, is the essence of what Jesus is getting across in the story. This son, this older, angry son, to come back and join into the celebration. Do you see what happened here? Don't just read over that. The father leaves the celebration that was taking place with the younger son and the servants and others, and he comes out where this angry older son is, this elder son, and he continually implores and invites this older son to come in. The son would not come, so the father went to him. It's a beautiful picture of the gospel. And really, I don't know about you, I can't speak for you, but for me, and maybe a lot of us, this is totally not what my response would have been had I been that father. I mean, my response would have been, you know, well, let's just say a whole lot, not very nice. That's why I'm not the loving father, right, in this story. That's why it represents God in his love. I mean, I would have been thinking things like, man, how could you do this to me? You know, I'm your father. Based on my authority and who I am, you need to get back into this house, right? You need to come and celebrate with the rest of the family. But over and over and over and over again in this story, this parable, we are reminded of the love of the Father, of the grace of the Father that has just been poured out and lavished on these sons, which represents the love and the grace of God, the Father that has been poured out and lavished on us as well. That, my friend, is grace. What you see in this story is just dripping with grace. We see the grace of this Father loving this elder son and loving the younger prodigal son, even in the midst of their sin. It reminds me how God demonstrated his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. All of this is a beautiful picture of the gospel of Jesus Christ. A secondary thought that hit me this morning. It's a reminder. It should be a reminder to all of us in this room. If you are a recipient of the grace of God, and if you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ who has turned from sin and self and turned to Jesus, then you're a recipient of the grace of God. It is a reminder for those of us that have receive God's grace. How can I give grace? How can I share grace with others? When you're in the middle of that difficult conversation or argument with your spouse, when you're in the midst of a dialogue with that coworker that you're disagreeing with, whatever the case may be, if you have been found by Jesus Christ, if you are covered by his grace, how can you, in the midst of that conversation, give grace to someone else? Remembering all the grace that you have received from God, all the grace that he has lavished upon you, you and I could never repay in a million lifetimes the grace that has been freely given to us through Jesus Christ. Amen? We could never repay that. By the way, that's a really good place for an amen. Amen? I mean, just consider the grace of God that's been applied upon your life. The Bible's very clear. There is none righteous, no, not one. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So if you're here this morning and you're a recipient of the grace of God, you have received infinite grace from him. And you didn't deserve it, and I didn't either. We did nothing to merit this grace. It was a free gift, freely given by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so how can I, what an indictment against me, against you, for us to say, I can't give grace to this person who has hurt me or this person who is hurting me, when you have received the greatest gift of grace from the Lord Jesus Christ of all time. How can we do that? How can I give grace? That's the question I asked myself this morning. That's the question I want you to ask yourself this week. How can I give grace to this person? As a recipient of God's grace, how can I be an extension of grace to this person in my life? Do you have an angry sense of grumbling? The self-righteous son did, and it separated him from this loving father and from other relationships as well, including his brother. Second question, do you have an inflated sense of goodness? Do you have an inflated sense of goodness? We see the grace of the Father. Notice he answered his father. Notice his inflated sense of goodness. Look, these many years I have served. The New Testament word there means literally I have slaved all these years for you. And it literally means continually I have slaved you. And I, notice this word, it's an absolute word, and I never disobeyed your command. Never. Yet you never even gave to me a little kid, just a little goat, a young goat. You've never even given to me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. Remember, don't forget this, the elder brother in this story reflects the self-righteousness of the Pharisees and the scribes. He says, look, these many years I have served you, I have slaved for you, and I never not once have I disobeyed your command. As I studied that this week, I was thinking to myself, never, not once did this elder son, I mean, he's living to a pretty high standard, right? Never, not once did he disobey the command of his father. How about the sin that he had in his heart right then and there? The sin of anger towards his father. See, a lot of times, it's not only the sins that we commit, right? Sins of commission. It could even be the sins of omission. It could be the sins that we participate in that we're thinking, you know, we're not being obedient to what the Lord's calling us to do. We're not making disciples. He's called us to go and make disciples of all nations. There can also be sins of omittance, not only sins that we've committed, right? Committed. And so the idea here is, even in his heart, was there never a time in his heart or in his thought life that he never sinned against the Father? That's a little hard to believe. How about the sin of pride? I mean, you see pride all over, self-righteousness in his attitude. How could he say that he never sinned against the Father? How about the sin of not loving others? In this case, his dad and his brother. I mean, those are just a few sins that we could think of. But this is the essence of a Pharisee in a nutshell. And I want you to hear me and hear me clearly. Pharisees are really good at seeing the sins of others. But Pharisees fail to see sin in their own life. You got to hear the heart of this passage this morning, church. The heart of the Pharisee is alive and well in today's churches. We are really, 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 really good. Or, depending on your perspective, really, 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 really bad at seeing sin in other people. But we stink at seeing sin in our own lives. And we'll excuse it away real quickly, but we don't excuse away the sin of others. It's the sin of the Pharisee. It's alive and well. It's not only a first century problem, it's a 21st century problem. Notice he goes on to say, yet you never gave me even a young goat in comparison to the fattened calf, the best that my brother received, that I might even celebrate with my friends. And so what we need to do is compare the younger prodigal son with the elder son. There's some contrast here. The younger son sinned greatly, right? We'll all agree to that, the text clearly alludes to his sin. In fact, if you remember, the older brother even kind of shared his sin. He said he spent all of his inheritance with prostitutes and prostitution. He was very eager, the elder son, to share the sin of his younger son. And we studied it last Sunday. The younger son sinned greatly, yet he confessed, pretty much in essence, I have sinned and I have no excuse. That was the younger son. The older son, on the other hand, in contrast, complains greatly, I have slaved and I have no reward. You see the difference? One says, I have sinned and I have no excuse. The other says, I have slaved, I have worked, and I have nothing to show for it. I have no reward. In the midst of an inflated sense of our own goodness, we've got to remember what the Bible says. The Bible says, as we mentioned earlier, there's none righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God. We're all sinners at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. Sin has separated us from a holy God. And so the question that we have to ask is, do you have an inflated sense of your own goodness? The Pharisees love to look at rules and regulation and religion, unfortunately, at the expense of a relationship. In this case, a relationship with the Father. And so we see sinful characteristics. Number two, we see self-centered causes of a heart that need changing. Self-centered causes. Look at the text, verse 29. We'll continue. The Bible says, but he answered his father, look, these many years I've served you. I've never disobeyed your command, yet you never give me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you kill the fattened calf for him. Did you count how many times in one verse that we see the word I, me, or my? It's all over that one verse there in verse 29. My count is five. There's five words of, look, these many years I have served you and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. Five times in one verse in our English text. What does that tell you about the elder son? Well, what it tells me is that the elder son was consumed with himself. He was all focused on him. He was all focused on himself. And there's a huge problem, church, with a self-centered life. It's not biblical, and it's certainly not Christ-like. That's not what we see in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself on Calvary's cross, right? Verse 30, but when this son of yours came who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. Notice all these phrases, when this son of yours came. The older son has reached a point where he would not even claim his brother as a brother. Do you see that? He says, it's this son of yours. So he wouldn't even claim his brother as a brother. Who has devoured your property with prostitutes. Remember, a Pharisee doesn't look at their own sins, only the sins of others. And you killed the fattened calf for him. He gets the best, I get nothing, in essence. Sounds like a two-year-old, doesn't he? Just a kid fussing about what's going on in the house. Not even a goat, he says. Once again, this elder son, the Bible's alluding to, is only focusing on himself. It reminds me of this story of this little boy and his sister many years ago. They were riding on the back of a wooden horse given to them as a present. And suddenly, the little boy kind of figured all of this out. And he turns to his sister and said this, if one of us would get off, there would be more room for me. And if you think about it, that self-centered, self-consuming, self-righteous spirit is in each and every one of us only by the grace of God. Is it not in us? But even at that, our flesh wars against the spirit, right? It's a struggle. If we're not walking in the spirit, we can easily revert, go back to that sinful, self-centered lifestyle that we see represented in this elder son. We laugh, but that's exactly what we sound like at times in the church. If any of us would get off, that would be more room for me. The legalistic, pharisaical spirit is alive and well. The next time you're about to complain about something in the church or something outside of the church for that matter, I want you to do three things. First, stop. Just stop and take some deep breaths. By the way, Mandy and the kids for my birthday, got me this watch, Apple Watch. And one of the coolest things about it is throughout the day, it will just pop up a little notification. It'll say, breathe. It's a good reminder. I don't know what it's picking up in me. If I'm stressed and it's picking up, my heart rate changes. I don't know what it is, but Unfortunately, several times during the day, it pops up a message and says, breathe, take time to breathe. Folks, that's what we need to do. I don't know that you need an Apple Watch to do that, but whatever it takes for you, you need to take time sometimes before you say something that you're going to regret saying or do something that you're going to regret doing. You need to stop and breathe. Just breathe. And then you need to pray. And you need to ask the Lord this question. If what I'm about to say or what I'm about to do is honoring to you or not. And listen to me. If what you're about to say is not honoring to the Lord, then you need to hush your mouth. You need to hush. And if what you're about to do does not honor your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who we've already been reminded of has lavished us with His grace, then you don't need to do it. If it doesn't honor Him, if it doesn't bring glory to Him, then you need to stop. And if He says no, then you need to repent for thinking it or not even, then not say it. And so, beloved, hear me. The fact of the matter is this. If we all got what we deserved, every single one of us in this room would get hell. If we got what we deserved, every single one of us would deserve hell, if not for grace. If not for the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, how should we live as followers of Christ? That's the question that we're wrestling with. How should we live as followers of Christ? Some of you remember hearing stories from maybe music history of Johann Sebastian Bach, the famous German composer. And he once said this, I love this quote, "All music should have no other end and aim than the glory of God and the soul's refreshment." Isn't that beautiful? All music should have no other end aim than the glory of God and the soul's refreshment. Where this is not remembered, there is no real music, but only a devilish hubbub, is what he said. He headed his compositions, Bach did, with J.J., two initials, J.J., Jesus Juva, which means Jesus help me. That's how he headed each one of his compositions. And he ended them with these initials, S.D.G., Sola Dei Gratia, which means to God alone the praise. Now I want you to think about that. As I thought about Bach's quote, I began to think, what if I started, not my compositions because I'm not writing music, but what if I started my day with Jesus help me and I ended my day saying to God alone be the praise? Think about how that would change how we live our life as followers of Christ. It would be a great reminder for every single one of us in this room that my day does not revolve around me. And beloved, it does not revolve around you either. It ought to revolve around our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and Christ alone. The self-centered cause of a heart that needs changing. Then finally this morning, we see the selfless cure for a heart that needs changing in our text. Look at verse 28 one more time. "But he was angry." This was the elder son. "And he refused to go in, and his father came out and entreated him." You need to realize this morning that we all have a sickness. That sickness is sin. And the only cure for that sickness is what we've been talking about for the last few weeks. It's the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Truly, His grace is greater than your sin or sins, whatever they may be. "My sin was great," is the idea, "but the grace of my Savior is infinitely greater." Don't forget that. And so, four things real quickly. Number one, observe the Father's passion. You saw it there in verse 28. Just to reiterate the point, the Father came to the younger son. We've already established that fact in verse 20 last week. And now, the Father comes to the elder son. He comes to the sinners. The Father does. He comes to the religious elite. He comes to those who don't even think that they need Him. He comes to those who think they have Him but don't. You see this in the text? It's a spectrum here. For the person in here that thinks that God could never forgive them of their sin, to the person in here that thinks that they're the cat's meow and everybody looks to them for everything and they've got a self-righteous, inflated view of themselves, Jesus comes to you too. And he's looking for you. He's looking for you. The idea is he will seek you and he will find you. What a beautiful picture of the gospel. God came to us when we would never come to him. Would not even be a thought in our mind to come to him. Jesus came to us. So observe the Father's passion here in the text. But secondly, observe the Father's patience. The patience. Look at verse 31. The Bible says, and he said to him, listen to this language. This is just beautiful. Son, you are always with me. And all that is mine is yours. Stop right there. The Father's reply is as gentle as the younger son's sin was great, and the older son's complaint was harsh. Let me say that again. The Father's reply is as gentle as the younger son's sin and the older son's complaint was harsh. That's how gracious our Father is. He addresses the son with tenderness. Did you hear it? He literally called him technon. In the English, it's literally child. My child is what this father, it's just tenderness. You see it in the text. Don't miss how affectionate this appeal is. It reveals his love for the older son and how he longed for the older son and the younger son to join him in this celebration. By implication, what's going on here? Jesus is still inviting the Pharisees to repent and receive the good news. Jesus is still showering his grace. Have you ever considered God's patience in your own personal life? If you're a follower of Christ, you do realize, don't forget, God patiently waited for you. And if you're here this morning and you're far from God, he is waiting patiently for you to come home. The Apostle Peter said it this way in 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient. Don't miss that. He's patient toward you, not wishing anyone to perish, but that all should reach repentance. Don't miss this Father's patience. Thirdly, observe the Father's privileges. Notice what he said there in verse 31. Son, you're always with me. Don't miss this. And all that is mine is yours. So first, the Father is showing appreciation to the Son's constant attendance. Said, you've always been with me. The Father's, it's almost like the Father's saying, he's kind of patting him on the back. My child, you have always been with me. You have always been there. He's showing gratitude. He's showing appreciation to this elder son. And then he goes on to say, all that is mine is yours. This property inheritance that they had divided, remember, he would have received two-thirds. The older son would have received two-thirds. The younger son would have received one-third. He says, this property inheritance, it still stands. He reminds the older son that all he owns belongs to him, to this older son. This older son, representative of the Pharisees, had it all. But like the Pharisees, he did not realize the extent of his privileges. The elder son should not lose sight of the benefits he's always had because of his access to the Father. And in a sense, he has always had access to the celebration. Those animals were always his. And yet this older son ranted about one fattened calf for his prodigal brother. You and I are privileged, church, that we have open access to the Father through Jesus Christ. We are blessed to be able to freely worship this morning and have access to a Bible in our own language. Most of us have stacks of Bibles. Friend, listen to me. You can have all this freedom and you can have all this access to God through Jesus Christ, and you can totally miss out on salvation through him, just like the Pharisees. Listen, don't miss the grace. Don't miss the grace of our loving Father. You see his passion, his patience, his privileges, and finally observe the Father's priority. Look at verse 32. was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. Literally, that word is, he's resurrected. He is alive, and he was lost and is found. It was fitting. Literally, what that father is saying, it was necessary, is what the father is saying. It was a holy obligation for us to celebrate and be glad. So what you're saying is not true, older brother. This was necessary for us to celebrate this younger son who has returned home, who was dead and is now alive, who was lost and is now found. Welcoming back the younger son was not only a good thing to do, the father's saying welcoming back the younger son was the right thing to do. And joy and celebration is the only proper response to such a situation. And did you notice in the text? And he's your brother. Did you see that? Whether you acknowledge it or not, he's still your brother. Don't miss the priority of the Father, church. You see the same message in all three of these parables. If evangelism, dead and lost people coming to life and being found, is the priority of the Father, and it is the priority of the Father, then it must be our priority as well. It must be. So how do I know if evangelism is a priority? Now, let me ask you this simple question. When is the last time that you had a gospel conversation with someone, believer, follower of Christ? When's the last time you talked about Jesus and what Jesus has done in your life to someone else? It's a gospel conversation. When's the last time you told someone about the love of God expressed through the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ? If your answer is never, then evangelism is not a priority to you. It's not a priority. If your answer is, it's been a while, then evangelism's probably not a priority to you right now. So let me encourage you something we've been talking about. Let me encourage you to begin with your one. Who is the one person in your life that God has placed on your heart that you know is far from God that needs to be in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Begin praying for that one. Begin having conversations with that one. That is the Father's priority. So what have we learned this morning? Our gracious Heavenly Father seeks those who are far from God, whether it's a self-righteous Pharisee or whether it's a prodigal son or daughter. He seeks those who are far from God, and He celebrates when they are found. Something hit me a few years ago when I was studying this passage. Did you notice that everyone is happy in these three parables but this older son that represents the Pharisees? The shepherd is happy because the one sheep is found. The woman is happy because the coin was found. The father is happy because the younger son was found. The younger son is happy because he was found. And the servants are happy because the younger son was found. The only person in misery in this entire story is the older brother. And I want you to think about how foolish that is. Instead of pouting, this older brother could have been partying. Instead of expressing resentment, this older brother could have been rejoicing. The feast is there. All he had to do was go in and enjoy. What a shame. Do you see how close this older son was to experiencing the grace of the Father? So close and yet so far away. And have you ever noticed that this is an open-ended story? Did the older brother ever come to the feast? Honestly, we don't know. The text doesn't tell us. It alludes to that he probably didn't, but we don't know that to be true 100%. We suppose that he didn't. We assume. But truly, we don't fully know. And I really believe that Jesus left this story open-ended for a reason. And here's the reason. Every individual must write his or her own ending to this story. Every person in this room. whether you are the epitome of a Pharisee or whether you are the prodigal. The question is, how are you going to write the ending to this story in your life? Would you stand with me? Our musicians are going to come. We're just going to have a time this morning where we allow the Lord just to speak to our hearts. In just a little bit, we're going to pray. And after we pray, we're going to have some pastors that are going to be available on either side of me. I'll be available. If you just say, you know what, Pastor, I'm far from God. I'm either represented by that Pharisaical son, that self-righteous son, or I'm represented by the prodigal. And if that's you this morning, we want to encourage you to come home. Come home. The Father is waiting to celebrate. He loves you. His grace is greater than whatever your sin may be or your sins may be. Come home. After we pray, we invite you to come this morning and just let these pastors just walk you through God's Word. Maybe this morning you say, Pastor, there's one in my life that I'm burdened for. Maybe it's a family member. Maybe it's a coworker. I don't know who. Maybe it's a child. Maybe it's a parent. Maybe this morning you may just want to come and pray. Just pray on their behalf that they would experience the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for Jesus. We don't deserve it. We could never do anything to merit it. But Lord, truly your grace is amazing. And it is the only thing greater in this story than the sins of the younger son, the younger prodigal son, and the elder son, and all of his self-righteous. And the only thing greater than those great sins is the grace of the Father, the love of the Father. That God demonstrated his love towards us in that, in the very midst of our sin, Jesus died. So, Lord, would you just speak to hearts and lives this morning? Lord, would you once again give us a passion, Lord, that evangelism would once again be a priority in our life, to have gospel conversations, not only as a church, Lord, would that be a priority, but, Lord, as individuals. Lord, would you speak to the heart of a Pharisee that's here this morning that's really good at pointing out sin in others but totally misses the sin that's in their own life? Lord, would you remind the prodigal, reckless son or daughter that's here this morning that they can come home, that even though they may feel shame and regret, Lord, that is to lead them to repentance, to lead them to Jesus for salvation. Lord, would you move in hearts and lives this morning? Would you do what only you can do by your grace? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, we have some pastors that are available. As we sing just in this time of response this morning, we invite you to respond to Jesus.
Of life's demand,
That we would not only be recipients of grace, but Lord, that we would extend grace to others. Thank you for these stories, Lord, and these reminders that truly your grace is greater. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And God's people said, amen. Amen. God is good
all the time.
All the time. Amen. If you'll remain standing, I think Will has a few closing words and then we'll be dismissed.
Just a reminder, before you leave, if you have not had an opportunity to pick up one of these prayer cards, there's about 40 or so sitting over here, and trust me, those teachers, bus drivers, maintenance guys, and women, they need your prayer this year, okay? So stop by, pick one of those up, and there are no services this evening. We're going to go ahead and give our people the evening off, spend that time with your family, and enjoy. So bow with me as we close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, just thank you, Lord, for allowing your hand to move throughout our auditorium this morning, Lord. I just want to thank you for, Lord, your grace. Lord, I pray that you just be with each one here as they may be traveling to see family. Lord, allow that time, Lord, to just be a sweet time. Lord, to maybe catch up on some things. Lord, be with us as we go throughout the remainder of the day. In your name we pray. Amen.